God bless you, dear brothers and sisters. Nice to see you in this new year, in this wonderful new year, and to have fellowship with you and with the Father and with the Son, Jesus Christ. Maybe you welcome your brothers and sisters with a smile, so that everybody can see that you're smiling by your eyes. And my question to you is, can you keep a secret? And I know a secret, but can you keep a secret? And yes, me too. Isn't it true that when we heard about a mystery back in the day, we got all curious, didn't we? And today, of course, as newborn or born again Christians, we are quite free from this not so beneficial character tendency. But in fact, today I'm going to talk about the greatest and longest hidden secret that ever existed, but which is not longer a secret at all, or at any rate should be. This secret is the basis of our faith, and hopefully it's the sole basis of your faith too. We read in 1 Timothy verse 3. Chapter 3, verse 16. 1 Timothy 3, verse 16. Great indeed, we confess, is the mystery of godliness. He was manifested in the flesh, vindicated by the Spirit, seen by angels, proclaimed among the nations, believed on in the world, taken up into glory. Jesus Christ came in the flesh, that is, bodily, to his earth and revealed to us through himself, God the Father. When we look at Jesus, his character, his approach to sin, and in a special way his approach to sinners, we see the Father and the Father's love. This revealed mystery, namely Jesus Christ himself, is the basis of the faith, and should also be and remain the foundation of our faith. Jesus' justification in the Spirit and his assumption into glory after death and resurrection is what makes us free from, and therefore also we should, may, can, must believe. The faith in him and the faith in what he has done for us is the faith that saves us and has saved us. The faith in the gospel, period. This sounds like you have heard it 1,000 times before, but my wish for you is that you hear it anew. The faith in him and the faith in what he has done for us is the faith that saves us and has saved us, the faith in the gospel. When faith is mentioned in the Bible, especially when it comes to fundamental things like our salvation, it is mostly mentioned as the faith. This is not just any faith according to the motto, the main thing is faith or a belief in this or that. And here is something else, and I absolutely have to pay attention to or understand or read this or that. No, but it is about the faith of the gospel that saves. It's about the core of the faith. The core of the faith. In the New Testament, this means the faith in Jesus Christ, the mystery hidden for ages and generations, but now revealed to his saints, says Colossians 1, verse 26. And 27 continues so beautifully. To them God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of this mystery, which is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We do not just believe in something or someone, but we become one with Christ, God's anointed and only begotten Son. The core of the faith is the core of the faith. If we hold on to this core of the faith, the gospel, more and more, or we grasp this core of the faith in depth without adding anything to it, then something very, very positive happens or will happen. We become totally independent of works, both of things we did well and of the situations in which we lacked or screwed up. No fame and no shame. We become totally independent of our ability or not ability. Completely independent of our appearance. We become completely independent of circumstances, both from the weather, the financial circumstances, whether we live in freedom or persecution, whether people or institutions are sympathetic or opposed to us. Even if we should be abused, it does not change our eternal salvation, which is by faith. We become completely independent of feelings. If we feel good, we are saved by faith in the gospel. Hallelujah. When we feel bad, we are saved by faith in the gospel. Hallelujah. We became totally independent of information, of news, of advertising, of intrigue, of books, and so on. Our guidance and basic attitude comes through the written and living word of God and the Holy Spirit from God Himself. We become completely independent from the old, not yet renewed thoughts swarming in us. That's an important one. We become completely independent from the old thoughts swarming in us. Neither our thoughts, if they are indeed from us, nor our logic should we allow to deviate from the once and for all revealed truth, the gospel in which we believe. Shame has no longer power over us, neither does pride. The past no longer has power over us. The future, no matter how it is suggested to us, no ungodly power. And so on and so on. There are a lot of things. Paul works all this out in great detail in the letter of Romans. Why we all are or have been sinners, and how God saved us in Christ Jesus from the power of sin. And because this salvation is by grace alone, and this grace is so abundant and new every day, he writes again and again, by no means. What do I mean? When he says, are we to sin because we are not under law but under grace? By no means. Do we then overthrow the law by this faith? By no means. So the law is good and not to sin is good. That's still, but the grace is bigger than that. It is God's goodness and grace which is visible in the gospel and which we may accept in faith. It is God's goodness that brings up that brings us to repentance. That is, when we have recognized God's grace, His goodness, the gospel, in its simplicity and genius, we will repent and walk in the ways of God, out of love. If we recognize this core of the gospel in its fullness for us and believe in it as unceasingly and as possible, and direct our hearts to God, our Father, if we do not allow ourselves to be sidetracked, then we will grow into a divine form of independence and be truly free. Paul puts it this way at the end of Romans 8. He writes, if you look up in the Bible, Romans 8, I read from verse 31. Romans 8, 31. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Verse 33. Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. Verse 37. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. 38. For I am sure that neither death nor life nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depths nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. I am able to do all things through him who makes me strong, Christ, says the epistle to the Philippians. 6. This expresses in a very strong way this independence from everything else. Nothing can or should take us away from the truth that we are saved and new in him. Through faith in him and faith in what he has done for us. Christmas, Easter, and Pentecost. Core of the faith. The faith in all embracing salvation through him and in him. A new creation. Old things are passed away. Not even our neighbor, converted or not converted, are we still to regard not by the flesh, the old nature. No one are we to call our Father but God alone. Our old ancestry is death, or not of no consequence. We are partakers of the divine nature. That is already the truth. There is no need to work on it in any way. The truth that makes us free in Jesus Christ and the faith in him and his work is our salvation. Hold on to the core of the faith, always. Faith means trust, always. The love of God is shown in what Christ has done for us. We are loved. Our value is determined by the highest price Christ paid for us. We are precious. The faith in the goodness of God and his work of redemption in Christ, which he has accomplished for us, makes us firm and independent. We are Christ-centered and have an anchor for our soul. When we believe, as the scripture says, we are no longer looking for water, but are a fountain for others. But this spring can only gush properly if we have the core of the gospel, the core of our faith, firmly planted within us. We are allowed to make mistakes. We are allowed to have doubts. We can be weird. Everything we think we are or do will never be greater than what Jesus has done for us. Do not exalt yourselves with a contrary idea. It only prevents you from the experience, the peace and the joy and all the good that God has prepared for you. Become firm in trust. If the commuter train breaks down, where is your joy? It makes no difference for the commuter train what your mood is, but it makes a big difference to the people around you. God loves you either way. Be sure of it. Rejoice in the Lord. Let him transform you at all times. He can. God can, he will, and he will transform us if we let him. He has patience and does not despair of us. In all this, seek the Creator, not the creature, or what the Creator can do for you. Seek the Creator. My prayer is that we do not expand the faith and add things to it, that we do not complicate what is simple, but that we internalize the faith deeper and stronger than ever before in our lives. There is no extended version of the faith, because in the faith in Jesus Christ, the Messiah of God, everything, really everything, is contained. With him, God has given us everything, also to you, now and even in your darkest moments. Amen. Father, I thank you. I thank you for the gospel and that it is easy to understand. Thank you, Jesus, that you came to this earth. Thank you that you were obedient and that your obedience was until the cross. Thank you that you paid for our sin. Thank you that you gave us new life. You deserve all honor and glory. We believe in you and your overwhelming salvation for us. Amen.